Good afternoon. Audio good? How you doing in the back? Can you hear okay? All right, right on. So are we going to survive the last session of today? We're going to make it, right? It depends on me. That's a lot of pressure. So welcome to Defending Serverless Infrastructure in the Cloud. So that's a fairly abstract title. And we like it that way because it means I can cover about 4 hours worth of content in 50 minutes, roughly. So that's what we're ultimately going to strive to do today. My name is Eric Johnson. I'm a principal security engineer at a company that I started called Puma Security, also a principal instructor with the SANS Institute. So this topic kind of coincides with both. I spend a lot of my day job hours building and securing clouds, and then I'm one of the co-authors of a SANS course focused on the same topic, which is automating and building secure clouds. My contact info is up on the slide, LinkedIn, Twitter, all that fun stuff. Let's jump right in here. So how many of you have used serverless in some capacity inside of your cloud accounts? All right, a lot of people raising their hands. You're in the right talk. This is good. So let's start with the basics here. In order to defend serverless, we have to all acknowledge that this is the worst possible name that we could have picked for this thing. Is everyone aware that there are servers being used here? Okay. It all comes down to responsibility model, really. Whose servers are they? Someone else's. Yeah, it depends on the cloud provider. We're essentially renting compute time in this space. So from a security perspective, let's talk this through a little bit. The benefits here, ultimately, are that you don't really own the hardware or the operating system that these little functions are running on top of. So we've eliminated some attack surface there, right? You don't have patch Tuesdays anymore. You don't have to worry about issuing those updates. You don't really have to worry about the downtime associated with those patches. So we've eliminated a lot of traditional operations by moving to a modern technology like this. Where are my development folks at? Any devs out there in the crowd? A couple that are brave enough to raise their hands at the security conference, right? I'm one of you too, so we're all in this together. On the dev side, we've also eliminated really kind of some framework patching. So if you're running some version of Node.js or some version of Java or some version of .NET, for example, you don't really have to worry about patching your execution environment anymore. So Microsoft drops that, hey, we just found a 0 day in the .NET framework, for example, and you need to upgrade from .NET Core 2.x to 2.y. Who's doing that for you in this scenario? Again, the cloud provider's managing that execution environment. What's really going on here is that you're writing this little function. So functions is the more appropriate name for this. And I've got the three that we'll talk about today on the slide. Lambda was really the first explosion into this system. We've got Azure functions behind it and GCP functions as well. Two of those are named right. One of them, you just have to kind of know that that's the name of it. But all you're doing is writing, let's just say, 250 lines of code to do some task or some job. You're going to write a function maybe to take some data and store it in your database. All that the cloud provider is doing is taking your function definition, which is your code essentially, and any dependencies that are needed to run that thing, and they're sideloading that into a containerized environment. So think Docker container here. That container is targeted to whatever language you told them to run for you. So if you want a Node container, that's what it does. If you want a Go container, they'll use the Go one. If you want a .NET Core one, then that's the container that it'll pick up, and it will mount your function into a volume on that container. That container is running on top of a micro VM that's, again, managed by the cloud. So you've got Kata containers or Amazon open source, their Firecracker technology, which is a really fast micro VM, so they can spin this whole thing up on the order of hundreds of milliseconds to run your 250 lines of code. And then when it's done, what's supposed to happen? It's supposed to disappear. And I'm going to say supposed to a few times here just to make you think a little bit as we lead into that discussion. But think attack surface there. We don't have the server sitting around running 24 hours a day anymore, do we? So we don't have servers to patch. We don't have frameworks to patch. There's no targets there constantly. Are we feeling better as security practitioners here? What could go wrong? Does this mean that we don't have to worry about security? We have to worry about different things in terms of security. That's really our mission for the entire session here today, is to understand this execution environment, what's actually going on inside of it. Once you understand what's going on inside of it, we'll take a look at how these functions are getting access to those back-end persistent storage areas like your database, your S3 buckets, your secrets management systems, all the things that it needs in order to actually communicate with the back-end cloud. And then we'll dig into how those functions are authenticating, where those tokens are. So a very red team approach here for the first half. And then after we understand the weaknesses behind it, we'll take a look at some of the cloud options for defending against those attacks, what we can leverage from a cloud networking perspective, and then what we can look at from an audit logging perspective to detect malicious behavior in these environments. So there's our roadmap. So let's take a look at the function execution environment real quick. Now, I was not brave enough to actually do live demos in this talk. So I recorded these, and at least I can walk you through what's going on. But there's really no better way to understand the execution environment than to get a reverse shell inside of it and start asking the environment questions. Does that sound like fun to anyone? You bet. Now, this was inspired, Gal Bashan, and he released this little tool called Lambda Shell quite a while ago. Has anybody seen the Lambda Shell project out there? It does exactly what the name is. It's a shell just like you're seeing on the screen, except when you hit the go button, it spins you up inside of a Lambda, and you can ask it questions. So taking a look at this, this particular example, I'm on an EC2 instance right now, and this is my quote attack machine. And what I'm going to do is open up a Netcat connection that's sitting there listening on port 1042. So now we're listening. We flip to our friend Burp Suite. This is running a function out in Google's cloud, and notice the IP address and the port that it's sending me back to. So I'm now sitting inside of Google Cloud's execution environment, and I can see, interesting, inside of this container, I'm running as root. That sounds fun, right? Okay, what OS am I in? Now, this is a Go function, by the way. So let's see where they land me. So I'm sitting in an Ubuntu 18.04 instance of Ubuntu. Where am I? I'm in the SRV files directory. What's inside of that? Oh, that looks interesting. What's that look like to you? Any Go developers out there? That's essentially a Go function. So from an attacker perspective, what you just found out is that if you find a vulnerability in this ecosystem that allows you local file inclusion, or LFI is how that's commonly coined from the acronym perspective, or command injection, you kind of know where you're sitting at this moment, right? Can that help you craft attacks? You bet. We'll get into kind of what's inside of this directory here in a little bit. But that's what I mean by what is the function's execution environment? What user am I running as? What host OS am I inside of in the container? Where am I on the file system? What contents are in there? Those are the sorts of questions from the red team perspective that you need to ask yourself. So we wanted those answers. In order to get that, now this talk is a distilled version of all of the research that we've done that's in a GitHub repository. So it's in the Puma Security Organization. Now, if you haven't heard of some of the research that we've done, we typically write our vulnerable applications and name them after various animals like cheetahs and cougars and stuff like that. So we wrote three functions. The Google function is called Cheetah. The Azure function is called Cougar. The AWS function is called Panther. In each one of these, in this repo, it has instructions on here's how to put this function in your cloud. Here's how to run it and do what I just showed you in that video. So it will get you a reverse shell into every single one of those execution environments so you can play the game and figure out what the answers to those questions are. But we kept going. We also hooked each function up with some actual permissions to do things in the cloud. For example, each function can read a secret from that cloud provider's respective secrets management storage area, like the Key Vault in Azure, for example. It can also reach out and talk to Azure Storage or S3 or Google Storage. So it can do some real stuff along with that whole command injection thing that I showed you. So we can really document how these things are functioning internally and what an attacker can do if you find a problem in it. So that's probably your biggest takeaway from this presentation is everything I'm showing you, you don't need to take pictures of the slides, you don't need to really write anything down. All of this content is in a markdown file in our GitHub repository. So you can just grab that and do everything I'm going to show you. So that's the resource, at least the takeaway. So here's the example reverse shell. I just showed you how to do that, or at least opening up Netcat, you invoke the function and you send that connection back into your attacker machine. Now, Brandon Evans is another engineer that helped me with this project. He even wrote an automated script that will do those couple of things for you. He tried to make it as easy as possible. So you just type pray.sh and hit enter, and it just spins up a shell for you. So it is that simple to repeat what we're showing on the slide here. So overall, I showed you Google's. So that's the bottom row on the table. We'll benchmark these three against each other continuously throughout this discussion. Google, by far, had the worst user selection. Remember that whole root thing? The other ones were intelligent enough to say, maybe let's run as a different user in the container. So you've got an Azure function running as app. Amazon's is an SBX underscore random number. That's the user account that they auto-generate for you. As far as the OSs go, is anyone surprised that Amazon has you in Amazon Linux 2? Makes perfect sense, right? Azure picked Debian, and this is for a node function. We're running the Azure function in node 12. We're running the Go function in Google for Go 11, 1.11, and then we're running the .NET Core function in .NET Core 3.1. So three different languages that you have to play with in that repo. What does networking look like was my next question. So now I know the user, where I am on the file system, et cetera. What can I do here? Now, this is the default in all three clouds. If you don't do something to change this, the second your function comes to life, you have full outbound egress access to the entire internet on any port. So it is just an egress star policy. That sounds cool, right? Remember, we're on the red team part of this discussion. So yeah, really cool, right? Yes. Now, what you can do is talk to the whole internet. And let's make sure that everyone understands this cloud concept. Every resource in your cloud that you talk to from a function, it doesn't internally talk to that resource through your own cloud account. All of those communications go out across the internet and back in the front door of the public cloud API. That's the main reason that's the default, is because in order for your function to log telemetry, or talk to storage, or talk to secrets, it has to get out to the internet and go in to the public cloud API the same way that I would from my laptop right here. That's the default network architecture. I can tell you don't like this at all, do you? No. We can change it. We'll get into how to fix this in a little bit, but that's what you're dealing with if your development team just spins one of these things up and runs it. That's the default scenario. So, what could go wrong here? Let's start with discussion number one. How many of you have seen secrets management maybe done not so securely inside of your organization? Everyone should either be raising their hand or you're lying. I've done application assessments for about 15 years, probably more, and I've seen a varying number of ways that we can screw this up. So this is my emoji list of kind of worst to best. So usually the first time you look at a system, you're going to open up some configuration.java file or a symmetric.java class or whatever, and right at the top of it, you're gonna see a final constant string equals and then some super secret piece of information that no one should know. That's the whole source code problem. And then this would never happen in real life. We just put that in GitHub and think no one will ever find that, right? So that's why we have the mad emoji on that one. So usually after a discussion, I'll say, let's put that somewhere more secure, and maybe they move that into a configuration file, which if it's done correctly, the config file is maybe automatically updated by a continuous integration or a build server, so it's not in the source control repo. So we've got a little bit of a better win there, right? But what if you have a vulnerability in your function that lets me read that file off the directory I just showed you? Can we get access to that very easily? You bet. What about environment variables? That's the next one on the list. That's usually where we'll move to next, right? Oh, no one could ever get the environment variables, could they? I'll show you how here in a little bit. So that's the grimmest. And then there's really the only, and I'm not even gonna say secure way, because we can undo this as well with enough research. But at least in this scenario, we're putting it in a secrets manager, and we're letting this function at runtime come to life and read the value from the secrets manager. So at least it's not in source control. It's not at risk on disk inside of your execution environment. It's not in an environment variable that's accessible by that process. It's in the heap in memory. Have we seen memory attacks before that have found these things? Absolutely. But that sounds more difficult, right, than me searching your GitHub repo? Are we seeing the difference between those two options at least? Okay, so that's where you'll see some of this stuff. The question first, how bad are we doing here, was where's the source code at? Now I kind of cheated and showed you the Google one already in that little demo video. And I paused it right at the point where we did an LS on that SRV files directory. So as you're looking at this, my immediate reaction, does anybody love YAML? A lot of people smile. You should love YAML because that's pretty much powering the internet at this point, at least in the Kubernetes world. So I immediately pick out this YAML file and say, okay, what could go wrong here? What's in that thing? And our Google function, I planted it there on purpose, but we can see, okay, if you've got local file inclusion, now we've got the database connection string, and I don't need your function anymore, do I? That whole 200 milliseconds thing, who cares, right? That database is alive all of the time, and we can just go connect to it directly, potentially. I also dumped the environment variables just for giggles. And I'm showing you Google's, which the first time we dumped this was actually very boring. I thought there'd be lots of cool stuff in here. All I could really dig out of it was, okay, I see the service account that the function is running as. We'll get into that. And I can also see the Google project, which is kind of the overall collection of all the resources for this app or this system, whatever it is. So their environment variables are kind of boring. We'll look at some other interesting items in here as we go forward, but that's really what you're looking for in terms of the source code and what you'll see inside of these things. So here's the LSLA command I just showed you in the demo. Oh yep, there's a YAML file. Let's poke into that thing, and yes, we've got some secrets in there. Environment variables, that's where I'm moving to next. If you don't hard code them in source, if you don't put them on the file system at rest in a YAML file, JSON file, et cetera, ENV is where you're heading next. So I showed you Google's, those were kind of boring. What about Azure's? What about Amazon's? Do you think there's anything interesting in those? It turns out that both of those execution environments have everything you need to compromise the entire environment. Perfect. So I'm showing you Azure's, which is actually set up better than Amazon's. I'll show you Amazon's in a little bit. In the Azure side, you dump ENV, and here's what you've got. You've got a couple of encryption keys. Does those sound useful? In order to invoke a function from HTTP or HTTPS, you have to give it an access key, or a little token. Those encryption keys for the container and the website auth essentially decrypt and validate that token for you. So that's what those are used for. We've also got a full connection string to an Azure storage account. And that storage account is where it's getting your code from. As the function comes to life, it's pulling your code from the storage account. So now you can start stealing source code essentially from that value. We've also got an app insights, application insights key. Does anyone know what that one does? Anybody use insights before? That's telemetry, that's monitoring. So when your function comes to life, that's how it's writing some of that log data into app insights, like how many invocations, how long did the function run for, did it return a 200 or a 500, did it work or did it crash? All of that data is going into app insights, which means, well, I could inject fake log entries into that system. That would be kind of fun, right? But overall, that's kind of boring compared to the one sitting next to it on line 7, which is an MSI secret. What do you think MSI stands for? This is some internal Azure stuff. So, managed service identity, yes. What do you think that does? That's a service principal credential, essentially the service account that your function is running under. Does that sound interesting? You bet. So we'll look at how we can use that here in a minute. So our fourth secrets option, should we maybe not use ENV or any of that stuff and just put them in the key vault? Probably the best way to go. So at least your CI/CD system, as your function deployment ships, it can provision the secrets separately, then deploy the function, and at startup, the function can read that value from the secrets manager. So that's the comparison across the cloud, secrets manager / parameter store, the AWS options. Azure's is the key vault, Google's is the secrets manager. Worth noting, the Google secrets manager is still in beta. Is anybody playing Google Cloud a lot? I ran into lots of beta stuff during this adventure. It seems like half the things are just in beta and they might be there for a while, I don't know. But it worked, it works great. So we'll see if they remove it and make it real soon. Here's just a very basic example of how you can take some secret, like that little database connection string, for example, and we can store that value in Amazon's parameter store as a secure string type, which will be automatically encrypted by their key management service. And then you give your function, this bottom piece here, permissions to get that one parameter on startup, and that's how it can read that connection string and go along its way and do its job. So there's a couple of things you have to do ahead of time to get this to work. How are we feeling on secrets management? Everybody happy? We know what not to do now, right? Just use the fourth option, the happiest emoji that was on that slide. Now, in order to access your secret, and this gets into the managed service identity concept, you have to create a policy that gives your function permissions to use some back-end cloud resource. And this is bigger than secrets. It's also storage, it's logging, it's telemetry, it's your database. Anything in that account that your function needs to access, you need to give it permissions to do so via some sort of a service account or an execution role or a managed identity. There's that MSI thing again. Now, they're all called something different across the clouds, but that's what you're looking for. Now, Amazon's and Azure's are very strict by default. They have very few permissions. Essentially, it comes down to logging. If you don't do anything, those functions can log their telemetry, and that is it. Does that sound like a good secure by default policy to have in place? You have to go into that policy and give it permissions to the parameter store, give it permissions to S3, et cetera. Google's, I about died when I read the default permission policy for a function. If you spin up a brand new function, I took a snapshot of their documentation. It uses the default App Engine service account to run this function. The permissions associated with that default App Engine account inside of the project that the function is in is full read and write access to all of the resources in that project. Does that sound excessive to anyone? Suddenly, I am super interested in hacking Google functions, because how many engineering teams do you think have gone through the trouble of creating a unique service account for every function and defining a very secure by default policy for it? Not many, right? One hand up. Well done. Well done. And because you knew about, yeah, we can cheer for that. That's awesome. So one thing I did find out, and I don't know if this is because Secrets Manager is in beta or because they were smart. I do not know the real answer to this, but by default, the secret that I created, the function did not have access to. I had to go into that secret and say, this service account can read the secret. So that was one thing we found in our research. But outside of that, you've got full access to storage. Nothing bad has ever happened from dumping all the objects out of a storage bucket, have they? So you have full rights to do that under the default account. And then we get back to the question of, you've defined the account and the permissions. How is the function authenticating to those resources? Now, from our perspective, this is magic. The cloud provider does it for us. So that means we don't have to worry about it, right? The next question on the red team side is, where are the credentials? Because each of these functions is authenticating to an API using those credentials. Do you remember where I said Amazon's environment variables were really interesting? That's where those credentials are. So all you have to do is dump ENV, and you've got the access keys for Amazon to talk to all of the different resources it has rights to. Azure's is by far the most sophisticated and the most difficult to get into. And I'll show you how that works here in a little bit. Google's is decent. Theirs is in the functions instance metadata service, which is a local link inside the function that you can talk to. So we'll actually get to see how all three of these work in different videos here in a minute. Let's take a look at Azure's first, because I told you that was the coolest one. Now, this took a little bit of work. I found that MSI secret, but I needed to know what to do with it. So what we had to do is actually reverse engineer the Azure SDK, the code, which is now in GitHub, by the way, so you can just read it. You don't have to reverse engineer it, really, but you need to look at the managed service identity class and figure out what it's doing with that. And what you'll see is that if you just look for all of the environment variables that start with MSI, notice you've got on line 3 an endpoint slash MSI slash token, and then a MSI secret. So you combine those together, and the curl command on the bottom part shows you what to do. You need to curl that endpoint and inject a header called secret, and then put the token in there, and that is going to return to you a JSON web token, a JWT, that'll get you access to the REST API for whatever service that you ask for. Now, notice on line 3, this is really important. They're actually really smart because JSON web tokens have an audience capability baked into it. So one token can be scoped to an individual service. Notice I'm putting storage.azure.com on that one. That token is only worth anything if you're talking to the Azure storage service. You can't take that token and talk to the key vault, for example. You have to request a new token scoped to vault.azure.net in order to talk to that one. So you have to steal a whole bunch of different tokens with all these different scopes in order to attack the account at a very broad level. So that's kind of cool, right? I have to do a lot of work there. There's a lot of command injection in order to really do some damage. Here's the JWT coming back, and when you decode that JWT, you can see the audience, and you can also see the expiration. So if you steal that from the account, you've got a while before this token expires to use it, even though the function's been dead for hours. So that's the Azure side, at least. Let's take a look at this next Google one. And I'll walk you through the same process on the Google side. And not only are we going to extract the token, but we're going to use it. So this leads us into the pivoting and exfiltration discussion that's in the next section. So we've got our reverse shell stood up at this point. And I'm just digging straight into the metadata endpoint. And I say, what service accounts are in here? And there's default. So let's query the default service accounts. And we can see there's a list of scopes and a token. Do those sound interesting? The scopes are awesome. What are the default scopes for this token? I have the entire Google Cloud platform, plus a calendar, Google Contacts, Google Drive, G Sheets, presentations, you name it, it's all in that token. So a little different than Azure. That token is good for everything, and you dump it. The other piece worth noting here is that that's not a JSON web token, that's just an OAuth bearer token. So we come in here, and instead of sending in my hard-coded placeholder, let's ask storage for all of the different storage buckets that are in the account. And it says, okay, there's one in here called the cheetah bucket. Okay, now I've got a link to the cheetah bucket, which I can flip over to the next request and say, what objects are in the cheetah bucket? All you have to do is replay again that stolen token, and you can list the objects in the bucket. Okay, so what objects are in it? Now we put a picture of a cute little cheetah in all of our different little functions, so we'll pretend that that's an important sensitive document, and we'll say, here's the link to download that item. We know the next part of this, right? Well, let's invoke that URL with the same token. And because it is so broadly scoped and it is so permissive by default, we can easily steal that token. So here it goes. There's the image. You have to believe me that that's a JPEG. Can we talk to secrets? You bet. It's the same token. The scope is open to that service as well. So again, now I'm talking to the secrets service, different API, using the same token. Let's go ahead and spin that token up, and we'll say, oh, look, there's that cheetah database password again. The one that I told you to put in the secrets manager, we now have access to again. So secrets managers are not perfect, but it's better than being in the source code. Are we good with that? Okay. So we listed the secrets. We're finally going to go grab it, and we can scroll down in this area. There's the data, which is base64 encoded. So you can decode that, and which I will do for you here. It turns out our database password is, after I decode this, is but unicorns apparently do exist. That's our super secret password buried in there. So that's the Google exfil side. That's kind of fun, right? Aren't functions great? And that whole thing happened over the series of a couple of minutes after the function was dead and gone, because that token has a lifetime associated with it. So we'll take a look at some of the defaults on these settings as we go into exfiltration. Now, what you just saw me do is invoke the gcloud REST API directly, because you cannot, from their command line interface, gcloud, just set a token and run with it. You have to actually authenticate to get a different one. So it's going to require you to read some REST API documentation. Not overly hard, but how many of you love to do that with your free time? I'm the only one, huh? Okay, Azure's is the same drill, REST API only with stolen JWTs. The Amazon one is by far the easiest one to use once you steal the credentials. Here are the commands, three commands. You dump the environment variables, you steal the secret access key, the session token, and the access key ID, set three environment variables in your shell, and guess whose cloud account you are now authenticated to? Whoever's function that was. That's it. So that's how simple it is. The command on the bottom part is how to copy that same picture from an S3 bucket. So very, very straightforward on the AWS side to do the same thing. The next question I had, and I know I'm starting to turn a little blue team on you here, was how long do these tokens live for? Now, I showed you the JWT expiration for Azure. Google's also comes back. So Google's, do you even see that little green bar on there? 30 minutes is how long that token is valid for. As you get into Azure, 8 hours, and Amazon's tokens are valid for 12. That's a pretty big difference. That's how long your attackers can use those Amazon access keys after they compromise your function. That's a long time. And guess what the best part is? There's no way to invalidate any of those tokens. So even if I told you I just stole your token, there's no way to say that token is dead. It is signed by the provider, that's it. The only thing you can do is go effectively set the permissions for that service account to nothing. So at least I can't do anything with the function, but guess what you just broke by doing that? You know, the function that's being used by all of your users. So that's interesting, that's the default. The next move here from the red team side was, well, we talked about that whole does the container stay alive for a bit piece earlier. Can you persist malware in here? Because in theory, this thing is supposed to live for 200 milliseconds and then die and go away. But then the development team started complaining a little bit. They want these to be fast. So what the cloud provider started doing is leaving the execution environment alive for a bit. And if you get a request, let's just say 10 requests within 5 minutes, those are all going to recycle the existing execution environment, which is persistence. So we put some malware, tried to. My first thought was, it'd be cool if I could overwrite the go function with my own code. That did not work. All of these environments are read-only by default across the three clouds. But there is a temp directory, and you can write to the temp directory. So where do you think the malware is going? Perfect. Okay, we have a location at least. And then you can run that. The process will die when the execution environment spins down. But guess what happens the next time the function is invoked again? Your malware is still there, and you can start it back up again. So we can effectively try to get persistence in this very ephemeral world. How long did the malware live for? This looks pretty familiar. Google's green bar is a little bit longer this time. But overall, in the Google world, about 3 minutes was how long that environment stuck around for. Azure's about 6 minutes, and then Amazon's, that malware was there for a solid 11 minutes inside of that execution environment before it disappeared. So that's what persistence really looks like in an environment that's supposed to live for 200 milliseconds. The big takeaway so far, so this slide is blue. Does it make you feel a little bit better, a little happier inside? We're going to shift to some defensive techniques here. But overall, the biggest question that I had as I walked out of everything I just talked to you about was everything I just showed you is magic. The cloud providers don't document it very well. They don't tell you what's actually going on. Why can't I, if I have some very sensitive workload running inside of a function, say, I want my token to live for 2 minutes, and I want this execution environment to truly die after 250 milliseconds? Do you see where I'm going with this? It's not configurable. The cloud providers don't let you change it. That's just the way the platform works, and we have to deal with it. So that was my big takeaway, at least on that opening section. Let's take a look at some audit logging and what's available. We talked about the Application Insight Service and how that's giving you telemetry. If you're looking at what your function is doing, so you want to know if your function is reading secrets or if it's interacting with storage, where do you need to go from an incident response or a monitoring perspective to see those actions? CloudTrail is the AWS audit service. Any REST API that's invoked anywhere in there, that entry is in CloudTrail, a very nice centralized service. I'm going to skip Microsoft for a second. We'll pick on them in a second. GCP was also very centralized. In your project, you go to the IAM audit logs API and you turn it on, and then you pick all the services you want audit data for. Secrets and storage, for example, and you're done. You check some boxes, we're good. Microsoft's was challenging. It is a very fractured scenario. So what I did is I went to Security Center, which is their primary threat intel service, and it said, Eric, your Key Vault does not have their diagnostics configuration set on it. So it told me that I didn't do it, and then I turned it on, and now I'm getting that sort of telemetry on Key Vault reads. But then I thought to myself, why didn't storage do the same thing? I've got a storage account. I've got stuff in it. It didn't tell me to turn diagnostics on for storage. And then I went and did it. And then it didn't give me any log data for it. Now, there is an open GitHub issue. as of Q2 of this year, storage is supposed to do the same thing that the key vault's doing. But you're seeing the problem here, right? It's different for every single service. It is not centralized across the entire platform or resource group, which makes it challenging to get the data that you need. So after I turned on our diagnostics on the Key Vault, I went to the Azure Diagnostics table, and you can run this little query that essentially says, show me all of the Key Vault operations where the service principal is this cougar, or this actual key, or the secret is cougar database pass, and let's just order it by the time that the event happened. Now there's some interesting data in here that might tell you if I stole your function's credentials and used them from my attacker machine. What are you looking at on that slide that gives that away? So we've got the same account reading a secret from a Microsoft managed IP address that belongs to your function, and then there's this other weird 95.0251. Does that look like an anomaly to you? So suddenly we have to read log files. Who loves reading log files? Who has time to do this? This is why Splunk has the huge booth downstairs or whatever. Because they can help you if you ingest the log data into it. So here's normal. 20.189 is a Microsoft IP. The client info is essentially the user agent. That's also very cool as well. Because if your function's written in C#, you would expect this request to come from the Azure SDK for the .NET request package. But then when I flip the slide, suddenly that looks a little bit different, right? That's not normal. There's a random IP address not owned by Microsoft, and it also is coming from a curl command, which was me just hacking away on the terminal saying, give me the secret, please. So that sort of telemetry is huge here. And from an incident response perspective, this is really all you've got. After that thing dies in 200 milliseconds, that's all you're left with is this little trail of evidence. Can we keep improving the ecosystem? Now, you remember that default network I showed you that said, here's what it does, and it allows you all outbound traffic to the internet. What we can start to do is override the default. Now, this sounds like work, right? Whose responsibility is it to build the custom network inside of your cloud account? We're taking some of the responsibility model from the cloud, and now we're having to own this. But this is the only way to get traditional network access control in place for your function environments. So in Amazon, you can build your own VPC. In Azure, you use their virtual network or VNet. Google's is the serverless VPC access is what it's called. The red star on Azure is interesting. In order to get this feature in Azure, you have to upgrade to the premium function platform. So it costs you some extra money. Like a lot of extra money monthly, like on the orders of cents versus hundreds of dollars a month. And the reason it costs that much is because we're really not dealing with serverless functions anymore in the premium version. Your function is alive all of the time. So really what you upgraded to was a virtual machine that's ready to run your function all the time. That's how you can connect it to a network. So it's not really apples to apples, but there is a way, at least, to get the controls that we'll talk about. So by default, if you do this, everything is broken. I broke the function. I cannot get log data anymore. I can't talk to the logging service. I can't talk to the secrets management service. I can't talk to storage because that function is in an isolated private VPC in a private subnet with zero internet connectivity. If those are your requirements for the function, that's awesome, right? I do not know many functions that don't actually do any work, though. So you usually need to loosen this up a little bit. So we'll get into how to do that, but the benefits here are huge. One, you control the traffic patterns, the ports, et cetera. You also get logging capabilities in terms of flow logs. All the ports, the network interface, the traffic, the source and destination address, it's all available for you in those flow logs. And if you're in a VPC, this is an important concept too. You can start to avoid those out around the internet API connections to the cloud provider and start to talk internally without the traffic hitting the internet. You get all of this if you build this out on your own. So doing this, this is an AWS example, and I'll stick with AWS for the next few slides just so it can flow and make sense. But this is using the serverless framework. Has anybody used the serverless framework before? It's really an abstraction layer on top of all three clouds to make it very simple to just deliver functions. So in the serverless config file, all I did was say, hey, for my function, I want it in a VPC. And for that VPC, I'm going to define the private subnets and the security group that this VPC or this function is going to use when it comes to life. So that's how simple it is to turn on. About 9 lines of YAML. Remember I told you YAML is really important? And you can use that to power hundreds of thousands of functions across your entire enterprise, reusing the same template. And then we get to traffic flow. How do you deal with traffic flow? We've got security groups, network security groups, and VPC firewall rules, all the same thing. It's essentially which port can you talk to and what IP CIDR block is the traffic allowed to enter, ingress, or go to from an egress perspective. So we're loosening this up a little bit. The function works again. Because ultimately what I did is I said, look, let's open up a security group, we'll hook this up to a NAT gateway, and we'll let traffic back out to the internet. And you can restrict it maybe to port 443, perhaps, and then deny everything else. So at least you're starting to restrict traffic flow. Here's your security group configuration that does just that. So that's 12 more lines of YAML in that default network config, and now we're locking it down to port 443. I did put an IP CIDR block in there. That's just if I wanted to restrict traffic to my actual network. If you need outbound, you're gonna need zeros on that. So it depends on what your requirements are. So that's what that security group looks like, which gives you network logging, more log files. Remember, we love those, right? So if you want network logs, you need to go in and actually set up that network configuration and say, deliver all of the VPC flow log data to this location. Now you've got log files. And we can start to build out queries looking for interesting things in there. So do you remember that command and control channel? I stood up and I used port 1042 just for giggles, right? So when you turn on the VPC controls, suddenly I'm getting rejects here. And those rejects are also showing up in that log data. So now you're detecting your function and the malicious behavior that I'm trying to cause in your log data, along with my attacker machine IP address. Are we feeling a little bit better here? So we're starting to lock this down a touch. And then we get to the private endpoint piece. So you can stand up these private endpoints and make your storage and your secrets available directly to your internal VPC network so you don't have to go out around the internet to get to our pretty cheetah picture. So now our updated diagram looks something like, here's our private endpoint traffic. That's all self-contained in the VPC, but there is no connectivity, at least supposed to be available to that resource from the public internet. So let's see, it's two parts to make that happen. One is you need the endpoint. So this creates an endpoint, more YAML. No one's surprised at this point, right? So we'll create an endpoint, and this is in US East 1, so that's in the Northern Virginia region. And what we're saying is make an internal endpoint for that network that my function lives in. Now the function can talk to storage from its VPC. With just that configuration, though, have I blocked the outside world from invoking it? Not yet, right? I've only made it so the function can talk to it. You have another step to do here. You need to go into that resource, for example, this S3 bucket, for example, and you need to set up a policy that says, hey, on this bucket, the only entity that can read content from it. Very important, line 7 is, The execution role that your function is running under, that's the only entity that can read this thing. And what I want to do is deny all requests if that execution role does not come from the function's network. So now, even if I steal the tokens and I extract them to my laptop here in the room and I try to talk to the storage bucket, I'm still going to get access denied because that policy's in place. And we've shut the last possible moment, right? But we've caught the attack at the last possible moment. Plus, when that exception message happens, it says, Eric, you're not allowed to do that. Guess what gets logged in the audit logs? You've also got access denied error messages, the IP address it came from, and a lot of that telemetry that you need. Are we feeling better about our function at this point? Okay, quick wrap up. I've got the 1 minute sign up here, a little beyond that, but next week, if you have thousands of these in your organization, what I would say is you need inventory. Is anybody surprised by that? It's like number one on the actual critical controls list. Centralize your functions, use your CI/CD pipelines to inventory these, and start scanning those functions for poor secrets management, LFI, command injection, et cetera. Within 3 months, what I'm saying is start to get audit logging and VPC flow logging centralized. And then you can start feeding those log files into your SIMs, your Splunks, et cetera. Getting into next level. This is kind of like a Netflix level thing. Start writing functions to help you identify malicious activity in your functions. So start scraping those logs, look for those IP addresses rotating, et cetera. So that's kind of the roadmap to hardening your serverless execution environments. I'll give a shout out to Gal Bashan, the original Lambda Shell, Brandon for helping me. There's also some really good resources out there in the Serverless Top 10 project out in OWASP, et cetera, that reiterate a lot of the points that we made here. With that, I will set you free from the last session. Thank you very much for attending and sticking with us through the day. I hope you enjoyed it. I'll be around in the hallway afterwards. I'm not going to hold you for Q&A or anything. So thank you.